JPMorgan's New York office asked this question in a recent Hirevue interview. How do you calculate a company's WACC? For those who are not familiar, WACC stands for Weighted Average Cost of Capital. WACC is a concept that often gets tested on during investment banking interviews, especially since it's one of the most important assumptions you make when you're doing a DCF or discounted cash flow analysis. In other words, a small change in your WACC can have a very large impact on the valuation of the company. So in this video, we're going to walk you through how to calculate WACC, and we're going to do it in a way that's so simple even a sixth grader could understand it. And once you understand it, you won't have to memorize the answer by brute force, because memorizing answers doesn't work, since your interviewers can always change how they ask the question, and they're almost never going to ask the exact question you happen to memorize. I can guarantee you that. Now, if you're new here, I'm Sam, a former technology investment banker at Morgan Stanley. Today, I run Wall Street Mastermind, where we've helped over 1,300 students who have collectively secured offers from every single bulge bracket and elite boutique investment bank on Wall Street. With that said, let's dive in and help you understand how WACC works once and for all. Now, before we look at the formula for calculating WACC, it's more important to have a conceptual understanding of how WACC is used. To do that, you have to know what a DCF, or discounted cash flow, is. We have another video that explains what the DCF is already, so I won't go into detail again here, but I will drop the link below this video if you want to watch that first and then come back to this one. But as a high level review, DCF is just a way to figure out how much a business is worth by taking all of its future cash flows and discounting it back to its present value, or how much it would be worth today. For example, if I offered you $100 today or $100 a year from now, you would rather have $100 today. This is because you can then invest the $100 you get today so that 1 year from now, you have more than $100, right? Similarly, if I offered you $100 a year from now or $100 2 years from now, you would rather have the $100 a year from now, because again, you'll be able to take that money, invest it for a year, and then have more than $100 2 years from now, right? So to figure out how much your $100 today would be worth a year from now, we need to know what is the expected return you would get if you were to invest that money today, right? Now, if I were a really conservative investor and I wanted to invest it in something really safe, like treasury bills, which is basically me loaning money to the government to earn an interest, I might get something like 4%, depending on what the current interest rate environment looks like. Now, that means if I got $100 today, I would be able to turn that into $104 a year from now. So unless you're willing to give me $104 or more a year from today, then I would rather have $100 today. Or if you can only give me $100 a year from now, then that would only be worth $96.15 to me today, because I can take the $96.15 today and earn a 4% return on it to get to $100 a year from now. Now, just to give you another example, let's pretend I'm feeling a bit more adventurous or had a slightly higher risk tolerance, and I decide to invest my money into the stock market instead of just loaning it to the government. In this scenario, I might say the expected return is about 10%, because that's what the long-term historical average has been for the S&P 500. So in this case, I believe I can turn $100 today into $110 a year from now. So unless you're willing to give me $110 or more a year from today, then I would rather have $100 today, right? Or alternatively, if you can only give me $100 a year from now, that would only be worth $90.91 to me today, because I can take $90.91 today and earn a 10% return on it to get to $100 a year from now. So what did you notice just now? If my expected return increased from 4% to 10%, then the value of $100 a year from now actually decreased from just over $96 to a little less than $91. In other words, the value of that future cash flow is now worth less today. So the same thing happens when you're doing a DCF. The WACC is the return that the company's investors would expect to get by investing their money into the business. If their expected returns are higher, then the company is going to be worth less today, which means the price they are willing to pay for the company shares are also lower. Alternatively, if their expected returns are lower, then the company is going to be worth more today, which means the price they are willing to pay for the company shares is also higher. So this makes sense if you think about it, because if I can pay less upfront when I'm investing, then all else equal, I should get a higher return in the end because it was cheaper for me to buy in. So generally speaking, there's a rule in investing that says high risk, high returns, low risk, low returns, right? This means that if an investment is considered to be riskier, investors will demand or expect a higher return to compensate them for taking on the additional risk. Similarly, if an investment is considered to be safer, the investors will demand or expect a lower return. This is why if you loan your money to the United States government, you might only earn 4% or less, because the US government is seen as the safest entity in the world for you to be loaning your money to, because in theory, it will never a default. If the government couldn't pay you back, it can always just go and print more money. Conversely, if you invest in the stock market, there is a chance that the stocks you buy will go down, in which case you might not get all of your money back. So there has to be a higher expected return in the stock market, or else nobody would ever invest in stocks and everyone would just loan their money to the government instead. Now, if you have questions about anything I've said so far, please drop a comment down below and I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can, okay? Or if you understand everything I've said so far, then it's finally time to look at the WACC formula and how it's calculated. Okay, so the WACC formula says the following, which is that the WACC is equal to the weighting of the debt times the cost of debt times 1 minus the tax rate plus the weighting of the preferred shares times the cost of preferred plus the weighting of the equity times the cost of equity. Okay, so this formula can be split up into three parts really. First, it's the weighting of the debt times the cost of debt times 1 minus the tax rate, which represents the debt holders, right? Which is why you see the small D there, okay? These are investors who loan the company money. And if the company didn't borrow any money and therefore has no debt, then this part of the formula is irrelevant and just becomes zero. Next, it's the weighting of the preferred shares times the cost of the preferred shares, which represents the preferred shareholders, which is why you see the small P there, okay? Now, these are investors who invested in the company's preferred shares. Not all companies have preferred shares. So if there are no preferred shares, then this part of the formula is also irrelevant and just becomes, again, zero, right? Now, last but not least, it's the weighting of the equity times the cost of the equity. This represents the equity holders, which is why you see the small E there, okay? These are investors who invested in the company's common shares. In other words, they bought a percentage ownership in the business. Now, within each of these three parts, the W in the formula represents the weighting, like I said, right? So for example, say a company raised $1 million of capital in total from its investors, and $200,000 of that is in the form of debt, which means the weighting of the debt would be 20%, because 20% of the capital structure is debt. And then the company did not sell any preferred shares, so the weighting of the preferred is zero. And then last but not least, this must mean the remaining $800,000 was raised in the form of equity, right? So the weighting of the equity would be 80%, because 80% of the capital structure is equity. Next, let's look at the R in the formula, which represents the return that each type of investors are expecting from investing in this business. So starting with RD, which we can also refer to as the cost of debt. Let's say the debt holders are loaning the company money at a 5% interest rate. This means that in addition to paying back the amount that was borrowed, the company has to also pay 5% of the balance owed each year. So the cost of debt is 5%. Next, the RP, or the cost of preferred. This is irrelevant in our example because, like I said earlier, the company doesn't have any preferred shares, right? But if the company did have preferred shares, the cost of preferred would be the dividend yield, okay? For example, if each preferred share costs $10 to purchase and the dividend was $1, then the dividend yield would be 10%, okay? But again, for our example, let's assume it's zero, okay? Last but not least, with RE, or the cost of equity, this is the return that equity investors expect to get for buying a percentage ownership in the business. The cost of equity is calculated by using the CAPM formula, which stands for Capital Asset Pricing Model. That is a whole separate topic, which we'll create a separate video on, but for now, just know that the cost of equity is always higher than the cost of debt. If the cost of debt for the business is 5%, let's assume the cost of equity is, let's say, 15% for now. Why is the cost of equity always higher than the cost of debt, you ask? Well, remember what we said earlier about higher risk, higher returns, lower risk, lower returns? Well, in the world of finance, investing in a company's debt is always less risky than investing in the company's equity. This is because if anything goes wrong and the company is gonna go bankrupt, the law demands that debt holders get paid back first before equity holders. So in those instances, the debt holders will usually get to recover at least some of the money that they loan until the money is completely gone, right? And the company's out of money, whereas the equity holders will get nothing. The investment becomes worthless, right? On the equity side. For these reasons, equity holders will always expect higher returns than the debt holders, okay? To compensate them for the additional risk that they are taking on. And the last missing part of the calculation is T, which is just the company's tax rate. This is because the interest expense on any debt borrowed is tax deductible according to the government. So for example, let's say the government's tax rate is 20%. Even though the cost of debt is 5%, we essentially get 20% of the 5% reimbursed to us because we can pay less taxes, right? So that's why we multiply the cost of debt by 1 minus the tax rate, and if T is 20%, then 1 minus the tax rate is 80%. Anyway, now that we have all of the assumptions, we can see that the WACC for this company is 20% times 5% times 80% plus 0% times 0 plus
80% times 15%, right? Which equals 12.8%. In other words, on a weighted average basis, the company's investors expect a 12.8% return on their investment when they invested into this business. So all of the company's future cash flows have to be discounted back by 12.8% to get back to what the company should be worth today. So at this point, you should have a high level understanding of how the weighted average cost of capital works. So the next time you get asked this question in an interview, hopefully you'll ace it. Now, if you would like more hands-on and personalized coaching with your investment banking or private equity interviews from our team of coaches, that includes the former global heads of recruiting at top investment banks like Goldman Sachs, Credit Suisse, UBS, and Lehman Brothers, then please don't hesitate to reach out to our team. Oh, and this is one of our first few videos breaking down the most commonly asked technical questions. So if you found this video to be valuable, please hit the like, subscribe, and share button so that we know to make more videos like this for you in the future. And as always, remember, nothing worthwhile comes easy, and nothing is more important than your future. So keep grinding.